All right, friends, in this chapter, we're gonna look at the churn rate. The churn rate is the percentage of your customers that are terminating their subscription over a certain time period. Let's take Netflix as an example. If Netflix has 10 million monthly subscribers, but 2 million of them are canceling their subscription every month, then Netflix would have a churn rate of 20%. Now, 20% is a really, really terrible churn rate, but actually not unheard of. Salesforce, as an example, had a churn rate of 8% back in 2008, per month. That means they were losing 25% of all their clients every quarter. Meanwhile, client acquisition was looking great. Sales was crushing it. And they were adding tons of new clients. But it was not until they solved their churn issues that Salesforce became the giant software company we know as Salesforce today. See, the problem with having a high churn rate is that churn behaves much like trying to fill water into a leaky bucket. If you add 20 customers in a month, but you also lose 20 customers in a month, churn 20 customers in the same month, you are back to where you started. It is not until you fix the holes in your leaky customer bucket that you start to make money. In other words, your growth rate needs to exceed your churn rate. That's why churn rate has a negative effect on so many other KPIs that we will look at in this course. And with a high churn, you can't focus on growing value of your existing customers, which is where the real money lays. This is also the reason why it doesn't help to bias these numbers. Or in Steely FD's words, the founder of Close.io, don't approach churn by trying to put lipstick on a pig. He says that because a lot of people have the tendency to calculate churn in a way that makes their company or department look better than it actually is. And there are a lot of ways to bias these numbers. But no one will be able to trick you, not after this chapter. Okay, so back at our Netflix example. The first important thing we need to learn is that the time period we measure plays a big role. It's because customers can't churn unless their contracts are up, right? Typically, we would pick the same time period of our subscription plans here. In Netflix example, it would be a monthly plan, right? Some other companies might offer annual packages. If you have a mixture of monthly, quarterly, annually, I generally recommend to take the average contract length. By the way, a neat side product of churn rate is that you can calculate the average time someone is a customer. All you need to do is divide 1 by your churn rate. In our Netflix example, we divide 1 by 20% and see that the average time someone is a Netflix customer would be 5 months. Like I said, 20% is a really terrible churn rate, and for sure not true for Netflix. Here's a graph for churn rate over time, and it shows why we can calculate the average time someone is a customer this way. As you can see, our average lifetime is 5 months. And if we don't sign up any new customers, we would be totally out of business within 20. Pretty straightforward. Let's have a look at the typical churn graph. And I'm gonna highlight a few hat tricks that you should be aware of. Okay, so what we are looking at here is a churn chart over the time span of a year. We can see that the churn rate is going down over time, meaning less customers are terminating their subscription. Happy campers. I typically like to include a trend line to make this extra clear. This graph works really well unless you are looking at churn rate of a company which is in a state of hyper growth. See, when you have a lot of growth, both your churning customers and your total customers will go up. By comparing both numbers to the prior month, your churn rate will go down, even if you have more customers churning out of your subscription than in the previous month. In this example, we see here twice as many customers are churning out of your product, 4 million instead of 2 million. Yet our churn rate is going down from 20% to 10%. For more or less stable companies, this is not an issue. Also, sometimes it makes a lot of sense to segment the products. Let's say you have a basic and an ultra premium enterprise plan. typically the lower tiers have a higher churn rate than the enterprise tiers. If you have a similar pricing in your company, I would probably separate them out. And be careful. If you have a highly seasonal business, let's say you have an app that recommends summer adventures, then I recommend to compare year over year in your chart instead of comparing this month's churn rate to the previous month's churn rate. This will give you a much more accurate picture. Churn is an important metric, and inevitably we will come back to it and look at the impact it has to other metrics. For now, the last thing I would like to explain is the difference between customer churn and revenue churn. So far, we've only looked at examples of customer churn, but usually speaking, we're way more interested to learn about our revenue churn. Why is that? Well, what if your customer churn goes down, but your revenue churn goes up? Say what? Yes, both churn rates can go opposite ways. This is what we're looking at right now. In blue, we have our customer churn going down. All is looking good. But our revenue churn in red is going up. Bad news. This is definitely not what we want. I'm sure we can handle less customers as long as we're making more money, but definitely not the other way around. Let's have a look at my KPI calculator. In blue on top, you can plug in your numbers to calculate the customer churn rate, and right below in red, the revenue-based churn. As you can see, both churn rates are calculated exactly the same way. We're taking the revenue we lost in a certain time period and divided by our total revenue made during the same time period. In green, I also included the inverted churn rate, the neat side product of your churn rate, to see the average customer lifetime. And if you want to copy charts I used in this chapter, please scroll further down. Simply make yourself a copy or download it in Excel format. So to sum up, the churn rate is the ratio between customers that are terminating your service to your existing customers. Having churn is like filling a leaky bucket. The bucket will never hold your stream of revenue if you don't fix the leaky churning revenue holes. With the inverted churn rate, you can calculate the average time someone remains your customer. And don't approach churn by putting lipstick on a pig. Choose a meaningful time span, such as monthly or annually. Separate out different product categories, such as expensive enterprise plans, and be careful in times of hypergrowth. And lastly, know the difference between customer and revenue-based churn rate. All right, thank you, friends, and see you in the next chapter.
Hi, this is Max. I hope you enjoyed this little video. I actually have a full online course about the most common SaaS metrics. I included the link to it in the description below. Please check it out.